الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وكنتني إن شاء الله تعالى with the fiqh and we stopped by صلاة العيدين. We stopped at صلاة العيدين. صلاة العيدين. And before we continue إن شاء الله تعالى studying fiqh as all branches of knowledge, this is as we all know that it's ibadah, it's worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and understanding the masail of al-fiqh is crucial. We have to understand it in the proper way. And that's why if you doubt that you maybe not understand a ruling or the mas'ala itself, after it's been explained, you have to ask. You can't leave yourself doubting what the mas'ala is or what the ruling is. So this is very important. As we said, the most important objective in this is to understand what every point, what every mas'ala means, what the essence of it, inshallah ta'ala. As far as the rulings and the difference of opinion, this is not necessarily as important in this level. So this is in the process of learning, not just getting to know something and then that's the end of it, inshallah. And we introduce every time some terminologies that we need to remember in Arabic, inshallah, to keep them that way. So for example, when we say Salatul Eidain, it's very obvious. Al-Eidain is the two Eid. Salatul Eid is one Eid. Al-Eidain is the two Eid. And the two Eid are, as we know, Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. There's no other Eid. No Halloween or Halloween or anything like this. We only have two Eid. Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. That's the only two Eid. And Eids, or Al-A'yad, is Deen. So that's why it's only we have two Eid, because people, even if people say that it's not Deen, but it's the Deen. لكل قوم عيد, as the Prophet ﷺ said, for every nation, for every people, there is Eid. And that by itself is a miraculous thing, by the way. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it in such a way, there's no group of people unless they have to have something to celebrate. This is how human beings are. So they have to celebrate something. Either to celebrate the haqq, our ayat is based on the ta'a, the obedience of Allah, the ibadah of Allah. Let's go into what's mentioned here. And if you have the English translation so that you can help me out by reading some of it if it's needed, inshallah. He says, Salatul Eidaini, the first point has been repeated, Hikmatu Mashru'iyatiha. The Hikmah, the wisdom behind it's been Mashru', and we said Al Mashru' from the Sharia, that means it's legislated, and it doesn't mean that we already know the ruling of it. Something Mashru', that means something is part of the deen. It can be fard, it can be recommended, it can be something else. But mashru' meaning that it's part of the sharia, part of the deen. So the hikmah behind it, salatul eidi min a'lami ad-deen al-zahira, from the apparent means to establish the deen, it becomes very clear when people are celebrating, they have eid, it's shown. It's not something that is hidden, something that shows the people. The people are outside, they're in the streets, they're making ibadah, they're making salah, and all kinds of things. ومن خصائص أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. One of the characteristics, uniqueness of the Ummah of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, because every Eid is unique to its people. So every people, they have what makes them unique, different than the rest of the nations. So this is the خصائص أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. يتحقق بها شكر المولى. What's the purpose of the Eid? To be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala على أداء صوم رمضان. Because of the fact that the people would establish the sawm or the fasting of Ramadan. And it's also Eid for those who did not fast because of a valid reason. Because the valid excuse is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're also, they celebrate the Eid because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the break not to fast because they have a valid reason. So it's for all Muslims, young and old, after fasting Ramadan, after ibadah, grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وحج بيت الله الحرام and the second Eid, which is Eid al-Adha, witnessing the Hajj for the Ummah, or part of it is making Hajj, and not all the Ummah can do this. So a small portion of the Muslims, they make Hajj, and the rest are celebrating Eid al-Adha. And with the many different meanings by it, by the way, not just these two. كما أن في العيد دعوة إلى التعاطف والتراحم بين المسلمين واجتماع الشمل وصفاء النفوس. In the Eid, there is دعوة, a call for people to have compassion, feeling towards one another, mercy towards one another, bringing the hearts together and the purification of the souls towards one another. And this is something that is always people are commanded to do. So even you would find in some of the hadith or even the verses of the Quran, even fasting on a weekly basis and on Thursdays, and it's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say to the angels, انظروا هذين حتى يصطلحا, that the people are forgiven except for those who have disputes. So a person would try to relieve the disputes so that the sins are forgiven. حكمها, we're in subject of fiqh. So حكمها, what's the حكم? جزاك الله خير. حكمها, what's the حكم of صلاة العيدين? And when we see the word حكم, that means what? We'll talk about one of the fives, أحكام. حكم out of five. فرض or واجب, they can be used interchangeably. It's okay. It depends on where you're studying from. فرض or واجب versus the حرام, مستحب versus the مكروه, and then the جائز. Some words can be used slightly, مندوب instead of مستحب, and the كراهة, it depends on some of the مذاهب, they use the word مكروه in the حرام, like كراهة التنزيه, as مذهب أبي حنيفة and others. But these are the five, and مباح can be جائز or مباح. So the five rulings. What is حكم صلاة العيد? As we have it here, he says صلاة العيد فرض كفاية. So the حكم of صلاة العيد فرض كفاية. فرض but كفاية. الفرض is of two types, كفاية and عين. فرض عين, that means it's فرض upon every person. عين, every person is فرض upon him, like الصلاة, the five daily صلاة. فرض كفاية, كفاية comes from the meaning sufficiency, or if it's if group of them they fulfill it, then it's not فرض upon the rest. So, and also it means if no one does it, then everyone becomes sinful. So this is fard al-kifaya, as it will come also like salatul janaza. Salatul janaza upon a Muslim is fard al-kifaya. If group of Muslims, they pray janaza, then everyone else is not fard upon them. But if no one, and in a community where there are Muslims, and of course, without having maybe their excuse, nobody told them or anything like this, then it becomes, all of them become sinful, because this is the right of the Muslim. But it's not fardu ayn, it's not an obligation upon everyone. And there are many things with furud al-kifayat, even with the permissible acts. But this is something else, we'll deal with it later, inshallah. So salatul eid, and you have to be careful, because it says fardu kifaya, this is in general. But before we continue, he said, وَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمُ وَالْخُلَفَاءُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ يُدَاوِمُونَ عَلَيْهَا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the khulafa after the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, they were yudawimuna alayha, they're consistently doing it. There's never been mentioned that it's to not to have salatul eid in one of the years, for example, for just no valid reason. It did not have never happen. So this is something that has been, that's why it's fardu kifaya. So because the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, if it was recommended, he would have skipped it one time to bring that meaning to the Muslims, that it's not mandatory, but it's never been missed. So that's why it's not fardu ayn upon every Muslim, as it's no one ever said that it's fardu ayn upon every Muslim in that sense, even though very rarely mentioned, but it's fardu kifay. But then, which is the next point here, which is part of the hukm, which is also very rare to see both hukm in the same ibadah. He says, وَهِيَ سُنَّةُ الْمُؤَكَّدَةُ. If it's something that is fardu kifaya, if some do it, then the rest are not sinful, then you would find that this in itself, sunnatun, recommended act in general, like salatul janaza also. If someone prays it, it's a recommended act, of course. So here also salatul eid, fardu kifaya upon the ummah and upon every community, and sunnatun muakkadatun fi haqqi kulli muslim. Then the hukm related to an individual, every person, it's sunnah mu'akkada, stressed sunnah for every Muslim wa muslima. And some had mentioned that it's wajib, it's fard, it's obligatory because the Prophet ﷺ never missed it. Like in the Ahnaf or Shaykh Hussain Tamiyah, he took that opinion. But here we're saying, and this is the majority of the ulama, fardu kifaya, and it's sunnah mu'akkada for every Muslim. Is it clear? So when you say fardu kifaya, you're not talking about an individual. You're talking about the community, the ummah. But when you say sunnah mu'akkada, that means it's for the individuals. في حق كل مسلم ومسلمة, for every male and female. وتشرع في الحضر دون السفر. تشرع, it's legislated, it's part of the deen, في الحضر, only for those who are resident, not for those who are travelers. So those who are travelers. في السفر, again, as it's mentioned for Jumu'ah. It's to be established in this, in the towns, in the cities, not in the desert or on the way when people are traveling. If you have, for example, again, like Salatul Jumu'ah, if a bus of Muslims, bus full of Muslims and are traveling for a trip, right? And it's the day of Eid in the morning, whatever, right? So should they stop on the way in a rest area or an open space to pray Eid? No. There's no Eid for them. If they go to a city, then it's to be established in a town, in a city. Yeah, but for a traveler, of course, the traveler, it's not mandatory for him if or her if they're on the way. So this is what is meant, وَتُشْرَعُ فِي الْحَضَرِ دُونَ السَّفَرِ, and not for those who are moving in the state of safar. So this is the hukm of صلاه العيدين, both الفطر والأضحى. شروطها, the conditions for it, like all of the different acts of ibadat, he says كَالْجُمُعَةِ, شروطها كَالْجُمُعَةِ, but there is exception. What is the شروط of the جُمُعَةِ? الوقت, the time, النية, وقوع حضرا, for it to be in the town or city, and the presence of the number of people that are to be كثيرا, to be a lot, in known by عرف, by what is used, or by what's the norm of being lots of number. And in صلاة الجمعة there's two خطبة, but here شروطها كالجمعة ما عدا الخطبتين, except the last condition, the fifth condition of جمعة that we talked about before, which is الخطبة is شرط, is a condition for the جمعة to be established. But for عيد, الخطبتان, the two خطبز, they are سنة, and سنة in the context of fiqh means recommended. It's only recommended. ويكونان بعد الصلاة. And the خطبتان, he mentioned that there is two خطبز here. This is the majority of the علماء are in opinion that the عيد has two خطبز, like جمعة. That means the imam gives a خطبة and then he sits and he stands up and gives the second khutbah. And here the khutbah in Eid is after the salah, unlike the Jum'ah. It's after the salah and it's sunnah. That means it's not mandatory for people to sit for the khutbah. So if someone prayed the two raka'ah of the Eid and left, no harm. His salatul Eid is valid, is inshallah accepted, there's no harm. They don't have to sit and listen to the khutbah. And if a masajid or people are making people feel bad if they don't sit and listen to the khutbah, this is against the deen. If people want to leave, they can leave. But if they decide to stay, then they have to listen and not to disturb the people. So this is something else. So either people leave, and when they leave, that means they don't make noise, they just leave the place, and they're not making loud noises and things like this because there's khutbah going on. Or if they decided to stay, then they have to be silent and to listen to the khutbah, but not to make it as an obligation upon them. And here it says khutbatin. If it happened that you, in Salatul Eid, and the Imam gives one khutbah, that's fine. And some actually said that. So here he mentioned two khutbahs after the salah. After the salah. So this is the condition of it. As Jumu'ah, except the two khutbah. So in Jumu'ah, we took five conditions. Al-waqt, the time, the niyyah, hadran, which is the same thing, being in town, and enough number of people. So can three people make it for Eid? Yes. according to others in practicality or the contemporary fatwas, or the abundance in numbers. And then you have the fifth condition here. Waqtuha. What is the waqt? What is the time for Salatul Eid? If you remember in Salatul Jumu'ah, according to what's in the book, that the time for Jumu'ah is like the time of Salatul Eid, right? Or it starts from the time of Salatul Eid, but it's best, and the Jumhur and the majority, that it's time from, it starts from Dhuhr, from the time of the Zawal. Here, the waqt of Salatul Eid, من ارتفاع الشمس صباحا قدر رمح إلى الزوال. From once the sun rises, قدر رمح. الرمح is the spear. I always mispronounce it. So it's the spear that you put in, you know, if you put it on the ground and the from a distance where the sun be above that. So this is where it's usually 10 minutes or more. Before that, no. After that, then people can pray Salatul Eid. من ارتفاع الشمس صباحا قدر رمح إلى الزوال. All the way to Salatul Dhuhr, to وقت الظهر, الزوال. Of course, there is some slight differences. The Prophet والسلام, used to make the Salah for Eid al-Fitr later than the Salah for Eid al-Adha. They're both after the sun rises, Qadr Rumh. This is where the time for it starts. And if they both Salatul Fitr, Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha, they prayed right after sunrise, after Qadr Rumh, that's fine, Salah is valid. But it's recommended, the Sunnah of the Prophet والسلام, that he would delay the Salah for Salatul Fitr. Why? So that people can give the Zakatul Fitr. The wisdom behind it, those who did not give Zakatul Fitr yet, they have a chance. Because once the Salah is established, it's not more, no more Salat, Zakatul Fitr, it's Sadaqah, general Sadaqah. So they missed Zakatul Fitr. It has to reach the poor before Salatul Eid. And the Prophet ﷺ would make Salatul Adha, Eid al-Adha, earlier, as early as possible. Why? So that people can slaughter the animals after the Salah. They have enough time to slaughter and clean the animals and all of this and eat from it. Because it's also from the Sunnah in Eid al-Adha, Eid al-Adha, not to eat if a person can. It's recommended that a person doesn't eat till he's, if he has an animal to slaughter, till he slaughter the animal and eat something from it. It's recommended, it's not a must. With Eid al-Fitr, it's the opposite. It's recommended to eat something before you go to the Salah, so that you are clearly not fasting the day of Al-Eid because you just finished Ramadan. But we don't have it here, so this is the waqt. The time for Salatul Eid from after sunrise, the time when the Salah is permissible. قدر رمح إلى الزوال, till the Zawal time. He says here a mas'ala. فإن لم يعلم بالعيد إلا بعد الزوال. The mas'ala here is if they don't know that this is Eid except after the Zawal. So people did not know that today is Eid. They slept late. They woke up in the morning. No one knew about the sighting of the Hilal. Whatever reason there is, did not reach them the news that today is Eid. If they get to know that before the Zawal, then they pray Salatul Eid. But if they didn't get to know it except after the Zawal, which is the end time of Salatul Eid, can they make Salatul Eid then qada'an, for example, at the time of Dhuhr, or what? This is, so the mas'ala here, they get to know the day of Eid after the Zawal. The ruling is, صَلُّ مِنَ الْغَدِي قَضَاءً فِي وَقْتِهِ. They would pray the next day in the time of Eid. So it's to be prayed in the next day. Also from after the sunrise, قدر رمح, till before the Zawal. So Salatul Eid, the qada of it, or to, if a person misses it, a person, not a person, if the people miss it, because if it's an individual, it's done. He does not make up Salatul Eid. But if group of people, they missed it, not also group of people intentionally missed it, if the city missed it, if the Salatul Eid was not established in a town, then they can make it up the next day, in the same time of Salatul Eid. So this is the waqt, the time of Salatul Eid. Clear, inshallah? طيب, كيفية صلاة العيد. How to make Salatul Eid? He says, وَصَلَاةُ الْعِيدِ رَكَعَتَانِ. Two rak'ah, so we all know. لقول عمر, عمر رضي الله عنه يسال: صلاة الفطر والأضحى ركعتان ركعتان تمام غير قصر على لسان نبيكم صلى الله عليه وسلم، وقد خاب من افترى. صلاة الفطر الأضحى تو ركعة تو ركعة means تو ركعة he repeating it for صلاة الفطر and صلاة الأضحى. أضحى تو ركعة and الفطر تو ركعة and الأضحى تو ركعة. تمام تمام meaning what؟ It's not قصر، من غير قصر. It's not تو ركعة that means it's supposed to be four and become two. No, this is full prayer. So تمام غير قصر. It's not قصر. It's a full صلاة. على لسان نبيكم صلى الله عليه وسلم. From the speech of your Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the lisan is the tongue. Refers to the speech. That means the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said it clearly. And of course established it that way عليه الصلاة والسلام. وقد خاب من افترى. He is a loser, the one that lied or made up something that is not according to the way of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Okay, so this is how Salatul Eid is prayed, but we didn't finish it yet. He says, وَيُصَلِّيهَا قَبْلَ الْخُطْبَةِ, to be prayed before the khutbah. And when Abd Malik ibn Uran or someone from the Khulafa, later after the Khulafa al-Rashidin, they saw that people are not sitting, listening to the khutbah, so he made the khutbah first. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ankaru alayh, they forbade this, and they said, this is bid'ah. This is innovation in the deen. The khutbah for Eid is after the salah, not before. So if people, they try to be smart and say, well, if you do it after the salah, people will run away. So let them, you know, let them listen to the khutbah. So they do it before the salah. This is bid'ah. And that's why also, يعني, I don't want to get into these types of details, but for sometimes people, they start giving instructions or donations or whatever the community, all of this before the salah, they shouldn't. People should be busy with the takbir. As if they're given a talk, but for whatever they say what we needed, because the community, all of them are present. If it's an emergency, it's a different situation. But leave the talk after the salah. And if people leave, they leave. He says, يُصَلِي قَبْلَ الْخُطْبَةِ يُكَبِّرُ فِي الْأُولَى. Salatul Eid is different than the rest of the salawat. Salatul Eid and Salatul Istisqa is the same. يُكَبِّرُ فِي الْأُولَى بَعْدَ تَكْبِيرَةِ الْإِحْرَامِ, after تَكْبِيرَةِ الْإِحْرَامِ, وَقَبْلَ التَّعَوُّذِ, and before saying أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, meaning in Surah Al-Fatiha, سِتًا. So six تكبيرات after تكبيرة الإحرام. So seven including تكبيرة الإحرام. So الله أكبر تكبيرة الإحرام, that's the first one. Or it's تكبيرة الإحرام is تكبيرة الإحرام for every salah. So it does not, it's not part of the count. Right? And then six takbirat. When to say the six takbirat after takbiratul ihram and before reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. Why he said وَقَبْلَ التَّعَوُّذ? That means after saying takbiratul ihram, you can say dua al-istiftah. سبحانك اللهم ربنا وبحمدك. Or إني وجهت وجهي. Or any of the ad'iyya of al-istiftah that can be said after takbiratul ihram. And then before saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين, then to say the first takbir, and then six of them after تكبيرة الإحرام. So we need to remember وقبل التعوذ ستا, before التعوذ saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم six times. وفي الثانية قبل القراءة خمسا, in the second ركعة before reciting الفاتحة five takbirat. That means five not including takbiratul intiqal. Takbiratul intiqal is the takbir coming up from sujood to standing. The Imam says Allahu Akbar, he stood up. That doesn't count from the five. And then he make five takbirat. He doesn't say what to say between the takbirat. There's nothing specifically mentioned about what to say between one takbir or the other. But as the ulama, they said, it came from some of the narrations. If a person says Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, there's no harm if there is time. مكان أدائها. So this is how to make Salatul Eid two raka'ah. First raka'ah, six takbirat after takbiratul ihram, before التعوذ, and in the second one, five takbirat before the recitation, after, of course, takbiratul intiqal or the movement from sujood to standing. مكان أدائها. The place to establish Salatul Eid. as we said before, Jumu'ah is to be established in the masajid. So that's why it has to be in town. But for Salatul Eid, it's best to be established, he says, في الصحراء. Sahara, Sahara particularly means desert, right? But it doesn't mean that, for example, here you have to go to the desert. You have to go to Arizona, no. So meaning in the outside, in the openness, outside of the city. And this is also, يعني, as the perfect place is outside the city, not in a hall or, you know, a bigger place than the masjid. When people rent a hall, for example, to pray Salatul Eid, that's fine. But because to accommodate the number of people. The sunnah is to be done in the open outside the city, if this is feasible. If it's not feasible, any place in the open, this is recommended. If not, then in the masjid. في الصحراء ويجوز أداؤها في المساجد. It's permissible to be done in the masajid. إذا دعت الحاجة, if there's a reason, whether not able, or it's difficult, or whatever, too expensive, or any means, then it's okay to be done in the masajid. Or forecast, raining, whatever. So all of that, then it's okay to do it in the masajid. But it's best to be done in the outside. And to be done in the outside, not because of the number of the people, this is the sunnah. This is the way the Prophet ﷺ, he would go out, because again, part of Salatul Eid, and part of the Eid, is idhar sha'air al-Islam, is to show the sha'air and the festivity of the Eid, which is ta'a, salah and takbir. This is something that is one of the objectives of it. And that's why even going from one way, coming back from a different way, all of that is because of this wisdom behind salah or outside of the town. Sunan Salatul Eidain, from the Sunan, recommended acts in Salatul Eidain, he mentioned some of them. Yusannu takbir al-mutlaq, أي الذي لم يقيد بأدبار الصلوات والجهر به في ليلتي العيدين. He mentioned here takbir. You know the takbir is to say Allahu Akbar. There is the word al-mutlaq. In the Eid, there is something called takbir al-mutlaq and takbir al-muqayyad. Al-mutlaq is when something is loose. So this is usually a word refers to something in general, at all times, not tied to a time or a place. So this is at-takbir al-mutlaq, to make takbir, to say takbir at all times, versus at-takbir al-muqayyad, which is the takbir to be said in a specific time. For the Eid, al-muqayyad is after the obligatory salah. That's what al-muqayyad is. After the obligatory salah, when people make salam, as it will come, inshallah ta'ala, that he will mention at-takbir al-muqayyad. At-takbir al-mutlaq, that means at all times. Whatever a person can to make takbir, which is, he defined the takbir mutlaq, the one that is not yuqayyad. When you tie something, this is al-qayd. When it's not tied to be said after the salawat. Wal-jahri bihi, and to say it out loud, fi laylatay al-eid, in the two nights of the Eid, and the night comes before the day. So the night before Eid al-Fitr, once the people see the moon of Shawwal, then to make takbir. And it's clearly stated in the Quran. وَلِتُكْمِرُ الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. And the takbir on the night of the Eid is even more stressed in Eid al-Fitr, because it's mentioned specifically after Ramadan. Once you see the Hilal of Shawwal, is to make takbir. تَكْبِرَاتُ الْعِيدِ. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa la ilhamd. And the matter is easy when it comes to what to say and how many times and things like this. But this is takbir al-mutlaq. For each person according to the best of their ability. And to say it loud. لقول تعالى ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم من سورة البقرة verse 185. وقال الإمام أحمد, إمام أحمد رحمه الله, said, كان ابن عمر يكبر في العيدين جميعا. ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما used to make takbir in both عيد. And of course it was well known that ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما was very strict in following the way of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. وفي عشر ذي الحجة, and then the first 10 days of ذي الحجة, also التكبير المطلق. From the beginning of ذي الحجة, not the night of the Eid also only. So the first to the two nights of Eid, to include Eid al-Fitr, this is the takbir is mutlaq. And for the first 10 days of ذي الحجة, also takbir mutlaq. ويذكر اسم الله في أيام معلومات, counted or known days, which is from the beginning of the Hijjah. These are the 10 days of the Hijjah. Right? This is takbir mutlaq at all times. طيب, what is the takbir? Takbir muqayyad. Amma takbir muqayyad, the takbir that is to be tied after the salawat only, وهو الذي يكون بعد الصلوات ويختص بعيد الأضحى. He says it's only for عيد الأضحى. There's no takbir muqayyad for عيد الفطر. There's no takbir muqayyad meaning after the salawat in the عيد الفطر. عيد الفطر, if you are in Ramadan, the last day of Ramadan, the Maghrib sunset, and people saw the hilal, or they saw the hilal, or they didn't see the hilal from the night before, you don't make takbir right after salah as part of you finish the salah. Like, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. You say astaghfirullah, 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 wa anta assalamu wa minka assalamu tabarakta hadha al-jalali wal ikram, and you say the takbir. That's al-muqayyad. You don't finish the adhkar and so on, and then you make takbir. No, muqayyad right after the salah. This is the muqayyad. In Eid al-Fitr, there is no muqayyad. It's throughout the night. And then after salah, if people make takbir, no problem. But you finish the salah, you make your adhkar. And then you can make takbir as you like, mutlaq. And as it will be mentioned, because when it's going to end for Eid al-Fitr, it ends by Salatul Eid. Once you see the imam coming, and people start standing for the salah, there's no more takbir. That's the end of it. Not after salah, not the day of Eid. No, it ends by Salatul Eid. So this is mutlaq. That's why the time of it is very short. And it's very stressed, the takbir mutlaq. And as for Eid al-Adha, this is where it has a takbir al-muqayyad. So the takbir al-muqayyad only in Eid al-Adha. Takbir al-muqayyad, it's easy to remember only in Eid al-Adha. But there's some details here. فَيَبْدَأُ بِالنِّسْبَةِ لِلْمُحِلِّ مِنْ صَلَاةِ الْفَجْرِ يوم عرفة إلى آخر أيام التشريق. It starts for the muhil. Who's the muhil? The one that is not in Hajj. So in Eid al-Adha, some people are in Hajj, and the rest of the Ummah are not in Hajj. For those who are not in Hajj, the takbir muqayyad, the takbir that is after the salawat, starts from Fajr of the day of Arafah. Day of Arafah is the ninth. Before that, it was mutlaq. From the beginning of the Hijjah, everybody's making takbir at all times, but not after the salawat. The ninth of the Hijjah, which is the day of Arafah, the Fajr Salah on the day of Arafah, for everyone except the people who are in Ihram and Hajj, everyone, they make the takbir al-muqayyad after the salawat, after the fard salah, from the Fajr of the day of Arafah, ila akhiri ayyam al-tashriq, till the last day of the days of al-tashriq. At the ayyam al-tashriq, we have the ninth, the day of Arafah. The 10th is Yawm al-Nahr, the day of the Eid. And then you have the 11th, and the 12th, and the 13th, 3 days of Ayyam al-Tashriq. So now we have 5 days of Takbir Muqayyad, Takbir to be done after the Salawat. It ends by the Salatul Asr, the Asr Salah of the 5th day, which is the 3rd day of Ayyam al-Tashriq. Once the Maghrib time comes for the 4th day, then there's no Takbir. Salatul Asr, they make Takbir then. This is for those who are not making Hajj. It didn't say anything about the people of Hajj. There is some slight differences here, but for those who say for the people in Hajj to make takbir muqayyad, for them in Arafah, there's no takbir for the Hajj in Arafah. The person in Hajj in Arafah, what do they do? In Arafah, they say talbiyah. They're still doing labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Right? And it's not after the salawat, it is at all times. And in the 10th of the Hijjah, for the people making Hajj, when they spend the night in Muzdalifah, and then on the 10th of the Hijjah, they start going to Mina. Once they throw the Jamrah, they're still making Talbiyah, by the way. Many of the people of the Hajj, once the morning of the 10th, they start saying Takbir. No, for the people of Hajj, they're still making Talbiyah, till once they throw Jamrah al-Aqaba, which is the last one closer to Mecca, then the Talbiyah becomes Takbir. So the Takbirat for them, after they throw the Jamrat al-Aqaba on the 10th, then they make the takbir. So then do they have takbir mutlaq? For those who said yes, then it's then after Salatul Dhuhr on the day of the 10th. So for the Hajj, it starts on the 10th of the Hijjah, not the day of Arafah, from the Salatul Dhuhr till the last days of Ayyam al-Tashriq. But we don't have it here. Okay, but here, what we need to remember is the al-muhil, the one that is not making hajj, the takbir al-muqayyad is from fajr of the day of Arafah till the last day of Ayyam al-Tashriq, which is the Asr Salah on the 13th of the Hajj. Clear? We know the difference between al-mutlaq and muqayyad. We need to remember, we're not going to say the absolute, what the word that they say in English?
They just said one is to be said at all times, the other one is at a specific.
No. When something absolute is, that means it's or mutlaq, I guess in general or so. But again, so we'll say mutlaq and muqayyad. So also in the exam, takbir and mutlaq. Takbir, we all know takbir. So we don't need to translate takbir. Takbir is to say Allahu Akbar. What's at-tahmid? To say alhamdulillah. What is at-tahleel? To say la ilaha illallah. قول لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك والحمد لله على كل شيء قدير. التسبيح زي سبحان الله. الحوقلة لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Right. So here التكبير المطلق is you so that you remember you know الطلاق. May Allah protect our all of our homes. What's الطلاق? It's divorce, right? But what does it come from? Let loose. They were tied by the marriage. At-talaq is they're loose. Right? So that's what at-talaq means. So the takbir al-mutlaq. And there is, it's actually used in aqidah too. When it comes to the believers, the al-aman al-mutlaq wa mutlaq al-aman. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ. The believers, those who did not associate partners with Allah, the amn is for them. Amn is security, peace, safety. Is it amnun mutlaq or mutlaq al amn? This is a different situation. Mutlaq al amn, that means any amn. When you say mutlaq al shay, this is a very important matter of not just an aqidah, in even usul fiqh and things like this. The word mutlaq is something that is going to be used. So whether mutlaq al-shay, the mutlaq of something versus the thing when it's mutlaq. When you say mutlaq al-amn, that means some security. So that means if they enter the hellfire and then they enter Jannah, they received mutlaq al-amn. But al-amn al-mutlaq, that means no hellfire, no punishment whatsoever. So the difference between both. But going back here, I'm just all of this so that we remember the word takbir al-mutlaq versus at-takbir al-muqayyad. Al-muqayyad is right after the salawat. It comes from when you tie something. He says here, وَيُسَنُّ. What يُسَنُّ means? Recommended. وَيُسَنُّ, it's mustahab. أَنْ يُبَكِّرَ الْمَأْمُومُ لِلصَّلَاةِ, that the ma'moom, he goes early. يُبَكِّر. He goes early to the salah. It's recommended for the ma'moom to go early for the salah, like salatul jumu'ah. وَأَمَّا الْإِمَامِ فَيَتَأَخَّرْ إِلَىٰ وَقْتِ الصَّلَةِ. It's not recommended for the imam to come early for the salah. But rather, he goes late. That means he goes to the salah only, because it's the way that the Prophet ﷺ would do it, and this is the sunnah, is that the people are sitting, they went early, and they're making takbir. They see the imam coming, they stand up. They see the imam coming, they're praying in the openness. So they see the imam coming, so they start getting up for the salah. There's no iqama for salatul eid. There's no iqama for salatul eid. The first thing that the imam would do is that he goes into the front and he says, istawu, and people would line up for the salah. So, amma al-imam fayata'akharu ila waqt as-salah. He wait till the time of the salah. Wa yusannu. And ويسنو, and it's recommended, أن يتنظف الذاهب لها, that the one going for Salatul Eid is to clean himself. And you see here, he said الذاهب, the one that goes to Salatul Eid. He did not say ويسنو أن يتنظف الرجال أو المصلي, because the women are also ordered to go to Salatul Eid, even if they are in their monthly menses. And they would sit on the side and they don't pray with the rest of the women, but يشهدنا الخير ودعوة المسلمين, as the Prophet ﷺ said, for them to witness the khair, the goodness, and the da'wah, the dua of the Muslimin, they'll be part of that to be blessed by the dua that is being done in Salatul Eid. Of course, with the condition of hijab and not mixing and all of these things. So therefore, anyone that goes for Eid, it's recommended that they are clean. You have a big gathering. So the same thing with the children. They go, everybody is to go clean. وَأَلْبَسُوا أَحْسَنَ ثِيَابِهِ, and to wear the best of their clothing. Of course, as long as it's not haram or showing awras, or, right? وَالنِّسَاءُ لَا يَتَبَرَّجْنَ بِزِينَةٍ, and the women, they don't commit haram by making tabarruj and showing their beauty or anything that they wear that is beautified and adorning them. So to observe the hijab. So as a rule, there's no exception whatsoever that women, when they go outside of the house, there's an exception they can adorn themselves or compromise the hijab because it's her wedding night or something like that, or because it's Eid. There's no such a thing. Hijab is hijab. And inside of the house, inside of her mahram, she do whatever she likes. So وَالنِّسَاءُ لَا يَتَبَرَّجْنَ بِزِينَةٍ. This is from the Sunan of the Eid. Also, Sunan al-Eid, وَيُسَنُّ تَقْدِيمُ صَلَاةِ الْأَضْحَى وَتَأْخِيرُ صَلَاةِ عِيدِ الْفَطْرِ. He mentioned it here. It's recommended to make صَلَاةُ الْأَضْحَى تَقْدِيم, not تَقْدِيم, that before its time. That means you do it as soon as possible. وَتَأْخِيرُ صَلَاةِ عِيدِ الْفِطْرِ, and to delay صَلَاةِ عِيدِ الْفِطْرِ, again for the reason that was mentioned before. وَيُسَنُّ الْأَكْلُ قَبْلَ الْخُرُوجِ لِصَلَاةِ الْفِطْرِ تَمْرًا, and it's recommended to eat before going to Salatul Fitr. That means after Fajr, to eat something, tamran, witran, as the Prophet ﷺ ate odd numbers of tamr, because it's haram to fast that day, plus coming out from Ramadan. Because Eid al-Adha also, the 10th is haram for people to fast. But people have been, it's not a fard fast that they had before, so there's no wisdom of that, as the Prophet ﷺ did. وَالْإِمْسَاكُ عَنِ الْأَكْلِ فِي الْأَضْحَى لِيَأْكُلَ مِنْ أُضْحِيَتِهِ, وَالْإِمْسَاكُ, to withhold oneself from eating till he eats from the أُضْحِيَة, from the sacrifice, if he's sacrificing on the day of Al-Adha. It's recommended. It's good to for that to be done. That's why after Salatul Eid, the most important thing is for those who are going to slaughter and to make it again for them to be to eat from. They don't have to, a sunnah. What's mentioned is not, does it mean that they make the feast and they cook everything and everybody? You can, when you slaughter, you can take a piece of the meat and cook it right there. But whatever people like to do, or the liver or something, like something easy can be cooked. Lebanese brothers, they eat it like that. They put salt and pepper and they eat the liver without cooking it. Remember one time we were in Ohio and we were slaughtering. And we had a Lebanese brother, mashallah, and he took, and the one that was helping with the, he's a non-Muslim. So he got the piece of the liver, and he says, look, and he put, and the guy opened his eyes, he says, you guys are, with all of what's happening in the media, you know, they were eating the meat like this. So it's a delicacy to them. I hope I didn't say anything wrong to you. So this is when it comes to the eating. Clear? We'll go to the Salatul Istisqa, unless anyone has questions, inshallah, we'll leave it at the end, unless it's something special. Totally. Mm-hmm. Yes. About raising the hands in Takbirat al-Eid. As a rule, anything that is Takbir while standing, raise the hand. Even though, yes, there is opinions and things like this. And Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, even in Salatul Janaza, even the majority, they don't raise the hands. But Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, and this is Madhab Ahmad, that he would raise his hands in Takbirat al-Janaza, and the same thing with Takbirat al-Eid, to raise the hand with every Takbir while standing. So to make it easy, always while standing, to raise the hand. But if someone doesn't raise the hand, it's fine. Of course, it's a recommended act. And to say Allahu Akbar, yes, people can say Allahu Akbar. And of course, the Imam is the one that says it out loud specifically. بس طب
Does this pertain to hypnosis or just human?
now, the point of cleaning oneself, does it pertain to the ghusl? Yes, the ghusl is recommended for before Eid. As Ibn Umar also radiallahu anhum, I used to make ghusl in the morning. There's no authentic hadith that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam would make ghusl, but we have the actions of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhum, and he's always, again, as all of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, known to follow the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Salatul istisqa, and istisqa is asking for rain. No.
Sometimes it mentions radiallahu anhu, sometimes not. So is this something that it should be memorized just like that, or can we add radiallahu anhu?
We should add radiallahu anhu, and because of actually the time, this was most of it copy and paste from like Kitab al-Tawheed, the hadith from Kitab al-Tawheed. So sometimes it's not written, different than how the books of hadith, if you take it from the sources, usually every word is there for, has a meaning to it. But radiallahu anhu is something that some of the books of hadith, even they don't mention it, but assuming that people would say that, inshallah. If it's okay with those who are online, inshallah, we'll keep the questions till after the salah.